I'll follow after you every day. I'll walk with you, my Lord. Every day, it's you I live for.
Dessert. Kara, is there any salad? No, we don't need salad. There's not going to be any salad. We don't need salad. Plenty of meat, plenty of potato salad, beans. We will be meeting in the new youth facility. All right, so that's where we're going to be sitting, in the new youth facility. And so walk on in, get your plate, and right over there. Okay? Also, what else we have? The Legacy Group, that's going to be for ages 50 to 65. We're going to meet up here at church this next Friday, Holy Cross at 6:30, and bring an appetizer, all right? Also today, the Hans are here. Josh and Candace, stand up. Stand up. Let's praise God for this couple right here. Here's the deal. Josh is going to be ordained into the Office of Public Ministry at Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Giddings on August the 14th. And so, congratulations. We always knew that you could do it, and you did. Went through seminary training, and we'll be partnering, and I believe you're going to be the executive pastor, is that right, of Emmanuel in the Giddings. We can't say more than how proud we are of you. And he's given me the honor of preaching at his ordination. So I can't wait. Trust me, I can't wait. So congratulations, and God has many, many more years. I looked at your age, and I looked at how you can do this for 30, 40 years if you want, okay? So that's a long time, all right? Well, congratulations to you, all right? All right, everybody, let's rise. It's good to see everybody. We do make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Crown him with many crowns. Again, welcome.
Crowns on.
Paul's letter to the church at Colossae. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, for you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge and the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Here ends our first reading. By the way, Scythian, I've been asked before, who were the Scythian people? They were a nomadic tribe just north of the Black Sea, which is now Ukraine or southern Russia. All right, our next hymn. Let's confess our sins and also hear the absolution. As we have always done in our church body, we take a moment for silent confession of our sins before God our Father. Take a moment and confess your sins privately. Let's reply to the words below. I know it has a B, but for the congregation and the pastor. Lord, we have sinned against you in thoughts, words, and deeds. We, your people, have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. Lord, we owe you a debt that none can repay. Forgive us and renew us, O Lord. When we were dead in our trespasses, God blotted out our debt of sin, nailing it to the cross. Having forgiven all of our trespasses, God has made us alive together with Christ. And dear friends in Christ, as a called and ordained servant of the word, I do announce to you the forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Stanza 3. Matthew, the 6th chapter. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Amen to that. Here ends our gospel proclamation.
Thank you.
as we do every Sunday, let's profess our true Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. In the name of Jesus, amen. Always good to be back from vacation. Feel good. You know, talk to most pastors, and you know, it takes the free. If you take 2 weeks off, it takes the first week just to unwind, and then the second week you say, "Well, I'm ready to go back to work." So that's how it is. Good to be back. Caused some trouble. The one thought hit me this past several weeks, and I guess it was prompted by a discussion I had with somebody at a counter. I'm not sure what store I was in, and I asked this person, "Are you a Christian?" I saw a cross. "Are you a Christian?" And the reply was, "Yeah, I'm a Christian." You know, I wanted to jump over the counter and say, "Hey, proclaim that with more enthusiasm." I mean, I scratched my head and I asked myself many times, can we, now think about this, I'm throwing this in your lap today. Can we identify as Christians and lose the amazement of being a Christian? Are you guilty of that? I know I am sometime. Can we identify as Christians and totally lose the passion of what should identify us as Christians? I mean, I know what identifies us as Christians, this and this, word and sacrament ministry, and us confessing Jesus as Lord and Savior, but also showing with enthusiasm who we are and whose we are. Have we lost the wow of being a Christian? I really think we have. And I'm not, per se, just speaking of the assembly here. Maybe you have. Maybe it's speaking to you today. But I'm looking at Christendom. I'm looking at the worldwide Christianity. What's going on? What happened to the gumption? What happened to the attitude? What happened to the Christian wanting to sit in the front seat and take control of society? What happened to that? What happened to the smile on a Christian's face and the proclamation of Jesus Christ? What happened to all that? How do you recapture your Christian wow? I really believe that we're inclined to answer that question one of two ways. We'll say something like, "Well, okay, I just need to be more motivated," or, "Okay, I'll throw God into my schedule." Right? Is it about motivation? I mean, motivation's good. I love all those motivational Christian speakers, you know, Zig Ziglar and all those guys. I love all that. I've been into all that. But the truth of the matter is, as good as motivation is, motivational statements are as good as they are, but they're not good enough. They don't meet it. They don't match it. And I'm not knocking today at all positive thinking. Positive thinking, however, is good as far as it goes. It just doesn't go far enough. I'll give you a good example. There are some days where I wake up positively negative. And I wake up positively in a grouchy mood. And I come in here to a staff meeting and I'm positively the hardest guy in the universe to get along with. It's not also is not only about our schedules. You know, just like we're going to throw God into a schedule. I never will forget, Michelle and I took a group of fifth and sixth graders to a nursing home. I'm not sure how long ago this was, 3, 5, 6, 7 years ago. And I told the kids, go in and give people Jesus. We made them cards and we're going to go give them Jesus. And we did. I remember one young boy who said, I don't want to go in, it's going to stink, it's going to be horrible, I don't want to go in. We took 35 kids in there with us. And I remember an older, elderly lady sitting in a wheelchair, strapped in so she couldn't move. Her head was slouched down. Now here's reality. I went up to her, and she had the stench of urine, unbelievable. And I whispered Jesus in her ear. And she looked up at me and she witnessed back at me. And she told me with a wow statement how much she knows Jesus and how much he's done for her. Here's a woman who is sitting literally in the stench of sin, who had no motivation except for Jesus Christ. You couldn't see it on her face. She had no schedule. They would roll her out into the main gathering area, roll her in to eat, roll her over to change a diaper, roll her back to bed. And yet, she had this gleam in her eye that was the wow of being a Christian. You ever seen people like that? Have you ever been and stood in front of a dying person's bed? And the only words out of their mouth is, Jesus has a plan for me. I get to go to heaven. You know, it's about being absorbed in God. It's about, really, through the Spirit's power, giving God a full yes. To acknowledge God as King and Lord, the King of your heart. To seek Him, to give God number one priority in your life. And yet we as Christians have the hardest time doing that because of one reason. We are sinful people from head to toe, all the way in and through you. Jesus tells us, focus on God. What does he say? Matthew 6:33. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Focus. And it's more than just adding God into your schedule. That's not the way it works. You know, I've noticed this now doing ministry for 30 years now. See, Josh, you can make it to 30 years if you want to. I've noticed that you just can't wedge God into your schedule and think, well, now I have all of my priorities refocused. God doesn't want to be a spoke on the wheel of your life. He doesn't want to be the hub. Or he does want to be the hub. He wants to be the center. And he wants you to encompass him in every single thing you do. So rearranging my schedule and refocusing my life are entirely two different things. You see, most of us, when we try to refocus our life, all we do is we just add stuff in. Are you guilty of that? You say, I've got a busy life. I am going to try my hardest. And how many people I've heard say, I'm going to try my hardest. I'm going to wedge God some kind of way into my life. I'm adding God in. I'm adding church in. I'm going to go to worship more often. But I've got a busy life. In order for all of us to refocus our lives, something has to happen. And something has happened to you. And maybe you have lost it. Maybe you don't wake up in the morning and recognize it. I chose this passage. This is what has happened to you. Do you confess Jesus as Lord and Savior? You professed the true God and the Apostles' Creed a few moments ago. Do you, and that's a question from me to you, do you confess Jesus as Lord and Savior? If you say yes to that, if you've said yes to that, these words are for you. 1 Corinthians 15, 51 and 52. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. I've got news for you. You get to go to heaven. Wow! So before we start working on all of our schedules and start reading all these great motivational books and we start adding all of this junk, we need to remember what it's really all about. It is about the forgiveness of sins. It is about the assurance of heaven. It is about, after you recognize those two things, because, you know, grace always proceeds. It's grace and then good works. After you recognize the forgiveness of sins, after you recognize that you get to go to heaven, then it's about a change of heart. Then it's about you standing up and saying, you know what, I'm going to wake up every day and give Jesus a big wow. I may be sick. I may be like the woman sitting in a wheelchair. I may not exude that, but my inner being is wow. Because it's about the grace of God. And after that, it's about the continued, as we do here every Sunday, proclamation of Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. And so we have a change of heart through the Holy Spirit. And then you've got the power to do whatever you want to do. God, who knows us best, gives us these words, Proverbs 15, 14th verse. The discerning heart seeks knowledge, but the mouth of a fool feeds on folly. Now, I want to pause here just a little bit. I want to talk about this. I've used this next illustration 10 times in my ministry. So if you've heard it before, praise the Lord. Maybe you haven't. It goes like this. A wise person is hungry for the truth. What's the truth? What's this? The Word of God. A wise person, you're hungry for the truth. And who is Jesus identified? He's the Word. A fool feeds on trash. Here's the difference. There's truth or there's trash. Because truth is all around us and trash is all around us. Would you agree with that? But the difference between the two is this. Truth is something that you have been given freely. It is in you through the power of the Holy Spirit. Trash is something that just gets dumped on you every single day. And you don't even have to ask for the trash. It just gets dumped on you. You see, if I don't have any truth in my life at all, and all I see is a trash can, I'm going to go to the garbage heap every single time. But if I've got a ribeye steak, baked potatoes, smothered in butter, sour cream, chives on top with shredded cheese, cheddar cheese, a glass of tea and some Texas toast, and I got trash, where am I going? I'm going to eat the ribeye every time. If I see the trash can, and that's all I see, I'm going to go to the trash can every time. That's why it is so important for you and for me to get the truth into our lives. I mean, it's sad today to know that there are people who are continuing to go to the trash heap because they've never been shared the truth, or they're deciding, I don't want to have anything to do with this. I would rather eat trash than look at this. And I can't say this enough. That's why, parents, it's so important for you to give your kids the truth. Because your kids are fed the trash every day. Trash is dumped on your kids every day. This church this morning ought to be flooded with kids. Where are they? Now, I know a lot of people are on vacation, but where are they? I hope, I pray, parents just didn't decide to stay home. It's about truth. We feed our kids the truth. That's what it comes down to. At the same time, we're sinful, and at the same time, we do make those bad decisions, and at the same time, we do, in contrition and repentance, come before God, fall before His grace, and know that we're saved. We're forgiven. But then it comes down to who's running your show. Because living the Christian life is a very, very serious thing. It's serious business. Jesus Christ, as I said on a Facebook post or on an email post to you, Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life. Jesus Christ is your Savior. And He exercises His lordship and expresses His life in you and through you. He has saved you, and now He lives in you and is preparing a place for you. If you confess that, and if you know that Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life, where in the world did we as Christians ever get the idea that we can draw a line on Jesus Christ and tell Him, we are going to follow you up into a certain point, and then we're going to do what we want to do? Here's the problem. We listen to a world, and the world is fun. And we are highly influenced by the world. But can the world influence the wow of being a Christian? It can't. So again today, how are you investing your priorities? And how are you getting the truth into your life? And what are you conveying to the people in your family and the people who aren't here today? Why is the truth so important? Well, John, the disciple, in the 8th chapter, the 32nd verse, gave us the answer. Why is the truth important? You will know the truth, and the truth is going to what? Set you free. That's it. Who's going to set you free? A bottle of whiskey going to set you free? Good. I hope whoever said that, I hope you remember that. When you get to be between 16 and death. What does the truth set you free from? I just love when kids listen. They listen. And he or she, whoever that was, is here today. Praise God for that. The truth sets you free from saying no to all the things that the world has thrown at you. The truth sets you free from all those things that you're bombarded with. The truth sets you free from the shame and the guilt. The truth sets you free to live a life that is abundant in Jesus Christ and to sit back and to say, wow. God gave us His truth. He gave us His gospel. He gave us His Son to set us free. I love Colossians chapter 2. Paul said, so then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in Him, rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. What is it for you? Who is your hub? Who is the center of your life? Right now, sitting in these pews in our new sanctuary, you need to answer that question. Who is it? And be honest. God is a God who says, you don't have to be afraid. God is a God who says, I'm going to take you by the hand, and I'm going to walk with you every single step of the way. And God, by the way, is not talking about perfection. None of us are perfect. But what God's talking about here is growth. He wants you to grow. And the Apostle Paul knew this exactly. And even though the Apostle Paul had a scandalous past and still lived in sin, had a thorn in his flesh, the Apostle Paul said these words in Philippians 3. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do. Listen to these words. Forgetting what is behind, straining forward to what is ahead, I, he said, Paul, press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Just take one thing at a time in your life. Are you willing to do this? Let me end with this. You know, the New Testament is full of people who encounter Jesus Christ
and we're excited. If there's any group of people on the face of this earth who should be excited about being a Christian, it should be us. The gospel is the most exciting thing that has ever happened on this planet. It's more exciting than the Super Bowl and a Super Bowl party, which are great things. It's more exciting about you falling in love and how cool that is. It's more exciting about you going to a Fleetwood Mac concert. I don't care what or whatever, Kai, just the first one that came to my mind. It's more exciting about than you standing with 102,000 people at Kyle Field. Do you see excitement at Kyle Field? Why aren't we doing that in here? Why aren't we living our life that way? When you grasp the awesomeness of what you have received through Jesus Christ, it will change your life. So right now, again, are you willing, right now? For some of you, you may have to start all over. For some of you, maybe you're weak in your faith. Here's the good thing. God doesn't give up on you. If I'm speaking to somebody in here about that right now, what you need to do is this. Say these words to yourself. All of us say these words. Lord Jesus, I want to make following you the number one priority and direction of my life. I want you, through the Spirit's power, to remind me again, right this moment, what you have done for me. And I want to make following you and living in the truth of your word, underneath the blanket of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the number one priority in my life and the number one way that I make decisions in what I do. Amen. And know that there is a wow. Show off Jesus. There's a wow of being a Christian. To God be all the glory. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and keep your minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the rite of friendship and the gathering of our gifts. If you're visiting with us for the first time, please write down your telephone number. We'd like to give you a call. One of us will. Also, if you need to update your email addresses, legibly update your email address. Legibly, we have a hard time reading those sometimes. If you're not receiving one from us, write it down. If you're a visitor, we want you to be part of our email system.
Built on shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the
Jesus, your name means everything to us, and for through you we are saved from our sins. Your name invites our sweetest, purest, and most delightful thoughts. There is no other name like it. Your name represents the greatest love ever demonstrated on earth, the Father's love that sacrificed you, his one and only Son, for us. Your name is a haven of refuge to our troubled souls, buffeted by the winds of hostility and adversity. It is our shield against the temptations as we walk through life, as well as our pardon for all the sins that we've done. Your name brings peace to our troubled conscience. It is the balm of Gilead that heals our broken heart. In your name, our prayers are offered, and for your sake, they are heard and answered. Your name is the name by which both rich and poor, small and great, approach God with faith and confidence. Your name, O Jesus, is God's promise to us of a better life beyond this one. It gives us courage for living and hope for dying. Week by week, gather us here in your name as Christian people in a Christian congregation to praise you and to be built up in faith and to love you through your word. Be present with us as you promised. Bless the hearts and soul of everyone. We ask all these things confidently of you, for you are our blessed Lord and compassionate Savior. In the name of Jesus, amen. We prepare for the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who both taught us to pray and invited us to ask, seek, and knock, assuring us that by his death and resurrection, he hears us and helps us in every time of need. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you. Amen. Jesus Christ, the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper. He gave thanks, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and drink, this is my true blood. It has been shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. However you feel comfortable in sharing the peace, let's share the peace of Jesus with those around us. You may be seated. Presence, Lord.
of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. Hangs on this. You make preciousness from dust. Please don't stop creating me. Your blood offers the chance to rewind to innocence, reborn perfect as a child. Everything there, my world begins anew with you. And oh, your cross, it's where my hope restarts. A second chance is heaven's heart. Outshone by this kindness, new life dawns over my soul. Oh, your cross, it changes everything. There my world begins anew with you. Oh, your cross, it's where my hope restarts. A second chance is heaven. Thank you. been given at the cross. Thank you.
now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ continue to strengthen you and also preserve you in the true faith and the life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Lord God, not only do you hear our prayers and pleas for mercy, but you also give us this feast of Christ's body and blood to assure us of your presence and to bring into our bodies the forgiveness won for us by the cross of Jesus. As we are nourished by Christ's body and blood, lead us to persistently ask, seek, and knock, that we receive, find, and be open to your holy will. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. One reminder, our next time we get together as one body, which I believe is one of the best ideas we've had, we're going to continue to do this, is going to be the last Sunday in October. You know what Sunday that is, don't you? Reformation Sunday, the last Sunday in October. We're going to get together, celebrate the Reformation, and also, what did I say? Yes? Okay. Michelle, whenever she grins and laughs at me, I think I said something wrong. Last Sunday in October, Reformation Sunday, we'll get together and have another feast together in Koinonia Fellowship as one body. Have a great week.
Darkness. peace and serve the Lord.
Dinner afterwards, okay? Come and join us.